and to pass it on to future generations. The Onondaga Nation brings this action on behalf of its people in the hopes that it may hasten the process of reconciliation and bring lasting justice, peace, respect among all who inhabit this area. I hope we can find a way to bring that justice. And we know, I think most of you know, that this land rights action is fundamentally different than the land claims that are being pursued by the Oneidas and that were being pursued by the Cayuga. There are no evictions, no individuals will be sued, have been sued. There's no interest in casinos. It calls for the healing. It is not disrupted. Disruptive, that's a word used dozens of times in both of those two decisions. It's kind of like a fear tactic. It's very much like the Bush administration saying, well, we have to do away with the Bill of Rights because we have all these enemies. It's too disruptive if we give justice to the United people or the Cayuga people. That's what the courts have said. Well, it certainly isn't justice. And the Onondaga land rights is not disrupted. The legal basis, as we've said before, is very clear. First of all, the takings of the land after the Constitution are in clear violation of the Constitution. The major takings by New York of Onondaga land happened in 1788, 1793, 1795, 1813, and 1822. All but the first of those are clearly in violation of the Constitution. The courts say the Constitution became effective March 4th, 1789. Actually, New York had ratified it the July before, July of 1788. Now, we know from Larry's presentation that they were already after Onondaga land before that, Oneida land before that, from the law that they passed in March of 1788. They were in such a hurry to get to the Oneida, Cayuga, and Onondaga land before the Constitution that they scrambled in September of 1788 to take millions of acres. They were in such a hurry with Onondaga land that they violated their own state law. New York had the equivalent of a non-intercourse act that said only the state can buy the land from natives, and you have to do it with pre-approval by the legislature and then ratification by the legislature after. Now, they did that because of the value in the land. They can't let individuals go out there and grab it because they'll get the value. In fact, there was a Livingston lease, a 999-year lease, that purported to take vast amounts of land for 999 years. Now, New York voided that by an act of the legislature. They didn't bother to tell the Oneidas and the Onondagas that they voided that. They used that as a scare tactic. It says, if you don't deal with us, those guys are going to take your land. Even though they voided it. They never ratified 1788 taking of Onondaga land until 1813, well after the Trade and Intercourse Act, well after the Constitution, well after the Canandaigua Treaty. But after March of 1789, New York knew very well it had no business to take Indian land. Didn't stop at all. Washington became so upset with New York's activities that he had Congress pass the first Trade and Intercourse Act in July of 1790. Very clear, very succinct law. Only the federal government can take Indian land under the conditions that Larry set up. Has to be a federal presence during the negotiations, and it has to be ratified afterwards. None of the subsequent takings by New York came anywhere near satisfying them. When Washington saw New York continuing to try to take Haudenosaunee land, he had members of his administration write the governor. These letters are in evidence. They're unquestionable. Written warnings. You're violating federal law. When this didn't work, Washington sent Thomas Pickering to negotiate a federal treaty with the Haudenosaunee in November of 1794. And it's important to put this in a historic context because we tend to forget about it now that we're the dominant world power. The United States in 1794 was on the brink of disaster. Washington's army were losing a terrible war in Ohio with the native people there, some British involvement. He was desperate to keep the Senecas and other Haudenosaunee warriors out of that war. And so he engaged in the Haudenosaunee Protocol, he sent wampum, he gathered the Six Nations leaders at Canandaigua, and they signed a treaty between the United States and the Six Nations on November 11, 1794. The treaty's still valid, still celebrated every year. And I want to read you just a little bit from this treaty, because you wonder what happens. The preamble reads, the President of the United States, having determined to hold a conference with the Six Nations of India for the purpose of removing from their minds all causes of complaint and establishing a firm and permanent friendship with them, and having met and conferred with the sachems, chiefs, and warriors of the Six Nations in general council, now, in order to accomplish the good design of this conference, the parties have agreed to the following articles, which, when ratified by the President and with the advice of the Senate of the United States, shall be binding on them and the Six Nations. Binding. I guess the Supreme Court forgot about it. Article 1 says, peace and friendship are firmly established and shall be perpetual between the United States and the Six Nations. Article 2 says, the United States acknowledges the lands reserved to the Oneida, Onondaga, and Cayuga nations and called their reservation. So the land they held in 1794 is from there on protected by the United States government. Say what you want about what happened before that. This is a treaty. And it says, we recognize it as your property. And the United States will never claim the same, nor disturb them, or either of the Six Nations, nor their Indian friends residing thereon, united with them in the free use and enjoyment thereof. But the said reservation shall remain theirs until they choose to sell it to the people of the United States who have the right to purchase it, reestablishing the principles of the Trade Intercourse Act and the Constitution. What good did that treaty do the Cayugas? Where is our governor? In order to understand even better the historical context for the takings of the land in the 1780s, 1790s, and early 1800s, we really have to step back a bit. And that's to the 1779. Let me see if I can catch up with myself here on this slideshow. In 1779, we have the horrible historic event of the Sullivan-Clinton campaign. There's no other way to describe it but a raid of terror. And these terror raids set up New York's taking the land later on, and I'll get to that. History has been distorted about these raids, but this is Washington's order to the troops that went out in two separate campaigns in 1779. The immediate objects are the total destruction and devastation of their settlements, destroy their villages, and the capture of as many prisoners of every race and age as possible. Prisoners of every race and age. It is essential to ruin their crops in the ground and prevent their plan, scorched earth, starve them out. This is George Washington. These are his orders in 1779. And as a result of them, on April 21st, 1779, about 2 miles from here, The Onondaga village was destroyed by a colonial federal army. Thirty-four prisoners were taken. At the time of the attack, most of the men were off hunting, so most of the prisoners were women and children. At least a dozen Onondagas were killed. Women were raped. The village was completely burned and destroyed. The crops were destroyed. Then the men, the warriors, came back from the hunt, and they took offense to the fact that the army had destroyed their village. And so they set upon the army as well as they could at that point. Scorched earth. We glorify. This is a 1922 stand. General Sullivan, hero, American hero. It's commemorated on 100 years, 150 years. We call Washington one of our founders. The Haudenosaunee call him Villagesburg. This is one of our historic markers. This is compliments of Bill Arnold. It says Indian attack. It's in Onondaga Park. You can see it right across the street from the city greenhouse. Today, I used to walk my dog past it because I own a house that's within half a block of here. I walk past it every day for 20 years. It says Indian attack. After we burned their village, took prisoners, and destroyed their land, we have the nerve to call it an Indian attack. And that's another example of our racist dealings with Native people. We turn the history on its head. And this reign of terror caused vast changes within the Haudenosaunee country, because they were no longer secure in sharing their woods for hunting. They no longer felt safe in their villages. And so many Onondagas particularly, but others, all the nations that were the victims of this. I should say that in April, the army came across Oneida Lake and set upon Onondaga. Then in September and October, a separate army came up from the south and destroyed numerous Cayuga and Seneca villages as it went up and down those two lakes. And so all of the nations, at least those three primarily, were severely impacted by this. And many of them, because they had no food, because their crops had been destroyed, and you couldn't just go to the supermarket. Everybody had to work very hard to put the food away. Because their crops had been destroyed, many of them went to Buffalo Creek, and they stayed there during the duration of the Revolutionary War. New York, when it began to try to get their land, played those factions off against each other. There's a lot of testimony about this in the Cayuga case before Judge McCurran, who ruled that it was part of New York's illegality. And New York would make a deal with whichever group of leaders they could find that they could make the deal with. And they said, well, if you don't treat with us in living on the land, we're going over to Buffalo Creek and talk to those other guys. That's the way they used this reign of terror as part of their way to get land. So that's the history leading up to the takings. Now, the courts tell us that we have to prove a new period of history. And we're preparing to do that. We have historians working since the Sherrill decision on what the history is since the 1790s. How many times did the Haudenosaunee go to Albany and Washington to protest the taking of their land? It's a lot of times. Now, somehow the courts seem to think that the Cayugas were derelict because they didn't go to court before they filed their land. Well, the reality is they couldn't go to court, and we will prove that. Any student of history knows that. Any student of our legal history knows that Indians didn't have standing to go to court. There are repeated rulings, and it's not until Oneida in 1974 and 1985 that the Supreme Court recognizes the right to file land. So where did they come off saying that, oh, you waited too long? So we're prepared to prove that history. And when we do, we will share that with you. And we will show that the Onondagas did everything they could to get their land back. The other part of the laches defense that was just handed to New York, they didn't have to prove it. Normally, when you raise a defense in a civil case, or even in a criminal case, you have to prove the defense. You have to put on facts that show that you're entitled to the defense. New York never had to do that. The courts just handed it to them. But New York will have to prove to Judge Kahn that they were harmed by the passage of time. Now, how was New York harmed? By the fact that they've been able to use this land, sell all that salt, sell the land for five times what they paid for it, and tax it for 210 years. Well, they've got clever lawyers, we'll have to see. And they also should be precluded from benefiting from their own illegal activity. The more we look at laches, the more other law professors. Joe Singer is not an Indian law professor. He's outraged. He's a Harvard professor who's written this stinging law review article about these decisions. They're just an excuse. Laches is used as an excuse. It's another legal fiction. Somewhat like the doctrine of discovery that they pulled out of their hat to justify the taking of Indian land. Laches was not fairly applied in these cases. There were no facts in the record to justify the Supreme Court's use of laches and Sherrill. There was not one word in the record in Sherrill, not one fact at all before the Supreme Court. I read every brief, every amicus brief, not one word just came out of the blue. There were some questions about it during oral argument. It's a little late then. Both of these decisions are based upon the scare tactic of disruption. We've talked about that a little bit. Onondagas are not disruptive. We all know that. And so the Onondagas are seeking the healing that we read about before. So the more I think about the Onondaga land rights in the US courts, I keep thinking about this history and the challenge that it presents us, and how miserably our courts have failed in the last year and a half. The case is also about culture. This is a slide that my wife Tarky and I took, or actually son took, of a trip we just took into Washington. But this is somewhat like what the woods were like before the Europeans got here, under the stewardship of the Haudenosaunee for centuries. And that's because of their culture being so much more respectful of the natural world, of understanding that we're all part of the natural world, that we're not the arrogant masters of it, that our culture has become. And the best thing that I can have been able to find that capsulizes that is a quote from the former Tarantino, Leon Shenandoah, that was in the book Wisdom Keep. Leon said, "Our religion is about thanking the Creator. That's what we do when we pray. We don't ask Him for things, we thank Him. We thank Him for the world and every animal and plant in it. We thank Him for everything that exists. We don't take it for granted that there's a tree there. We thank the Creator for that tree, because if we don't thank Him, maybe the Creator will take that tree away. That's what our ceremonies are about, and that's why they're important." What do we have? These are a composite of clear cuttings, miles from that other forest, where we just rape the land and ship it off at a profit. That's our culture. Somehow we say that's superior. And as we know, The land rights is about you. So our task as citizens of one side of that treaty, and we all know there are two previous treaties in 1784 and 1789, but Canandaigua is the clearest. And our government has obligations under that treaty that it is failing. We promised peace and friendship and free use and enjoyment of their land forever. We need to push the federal and state government for the truth and reconciliation that are necessary for the true healing. We need to make amends for the ethnic cleansing, the genocide, and the illegal taking of their land. Since the courts have failed so miserably, we need to get more and more people to think about the choices that we have. We need to acknowledge the historic truths. We've only glanced at them. It's much worse. You know that. You know about the Trail of Tears. You know about what happened as they moved westward. We need to seek that healing and reconciliation that is so important here. We need to clean up Onondaga. We need